I would like to explain briefly about the country named South Africa. There was an apartheid in South Africa, and then the white people were controlling them, and then they used to separate blacks from whites, and then they used to have different types of groups. They have the colored, the black, the white, and the Indian. So they said if you are in South African, if you are Indian, you are supposed to marry Indian. If they catch you married another person or colored, you are Indian, then you married colored person, the law will bite you hard. So that was their rule, and they was having 148 rules in South Africa. And anyone that goes above that rule, the law will bite the person. And then is there the author write this book that says Journey to Joburg. The author is Rivali Nidiu. So this book is about two girls. They are similar. Nalendi and Tyrone. Nalendi was 4 years old than Tyrone. She was the eldest. And then Tyrone knew his sister that whatever thing his sister said, it's the fact. His sister won't turn back like that. She won't say anything unless his mother said, okay, this one has true, let's jump to another one. So the author write this book. I will start read the book and join to Joburg. Once they are living a girl, Nalindi, and a boy, Tyrone. Nalindi was so confident that his sister was ill. And then she wanted her sister not to get die before her time, and she went quickly to Johannesburg. Her mother was staying there. She lived with her two parents, and then Nalindi was thinking, always sitting on her bed wherever she sat, saying, oh God, I wish that you would make me meet Uma one day. She was wishing. This boy Taro wouldn't say anything because knew his sister that as soon as his sister say anything, that's the fact. They walk to that one. So they started doing their journey, but before they went there, they met their friends, and then the friend helped them, give them some sweet potatoes and water so that when they are going on their journey, they will be safety, and then no one will ask them. So as they were going, they met an orange tree. They started walking, but Tyro, know that he's a little boy, can't handle his stomach, so started crying, oh Nalindi, I'm tired, I've walked a lot, I'm tired now, I want to sit, I want to have a rest. But Nalindi was confident, and then she was moving on. Tyro did not say anything again until they reached to the end of the hill, and then Nalindi sat there now, and they said, let's eat this first meal. And then when we went out to Johannesburg, we will meet Ma there, because they used to call their mother Ma. So they sat there and eat. But it was midday now. The sun is getting down. So they started when they are walking along, they saw orange farm. It was full of orange barrels. The orange were barrels. And then, as you can see the map here, this is the map. These are the orange trees that they passed. These are the orange trees, and then the trails that passed through there, and then so on and so forth. So there was passed when they sat there, they have eaten their meal. It's midday now, the sun is getting down. So they started thinking, yeah, they should rest for this night to pass them, but they did not have anywhere. So they saw the orange tree, and then they wanted to pick it, but when they entered, it was fenced by a mesh. The farm was fenced by a mesh. So I was afraid. Tyro was crying, oh Nalindi, don't go there, Nalindi, don't go there, because he was confused, he doesn't know anything to do. So Nalindi kept on walking as she knows. Then she kept on walking. As soon as she enters the farm, and then she tried to pick some oranges, and the woman shouted, "Hey, you, what are you doing there?" And she was shocked. As soon as she wanted to run, the boy grabbed her and asked her, "Where are you going to? You know that this white man that owns this farm can't allow black people to come inside here because he's a white people and then they used to rule our country. So please go back." But the boy was a good friend. He was speaking twice now. He was a good friend. Sometimes Nalinga understands, sometimes Nalinga doesn't understand. He was a good friend, and then he was so intelligent. And then he gives Nalinga and Tyrone a place to sleep. And then he asks them, "When you are picking these oranges, please hide the pills somewhere else, because if the farmers that own this farm catches you, he will shoot you. He has a gun." And then Nalinga was so confident. She dug a hole, and then she put the pills there, and then she closed it. The next morning, Taro wake up. "Nalinga, let's go. It's time for us. Let's go, let's go." So Nalinga was not talking. The boy won't come with for them a pap, and then they ate it. After that, they went back. The boy said goodbye to Nalinga and Taro. They went back. So when they were going on their way, they saw a truck. But this truck passed through. The man that was inside the truck started saying, "Hey, you, can't you use your head passing along the way without knowing? Said if any car hits you, no one will ask the driver, so better stay outside." So there they met their good friend that's named Grace. So Grace said, "If you don't know these people, you should have a pass. Did you have a pass?" She questioned Nalinga. Then Nalinga explained to her story, and then they became good friends again. Grace became good friends together. And then after that, Grace went with them back. Grace paid for them the fee for the train, the enters, and then Grace started explaining to them. So Grace was going down to his mother. So our mother, we are Nalinga and Taiwo, we are going to. So she's also said that, "Okay, all of us will go. So I'll wait for you here, and then when you go and come back, you meet me here, and then all of us will go. I will find somewhere else that you will stay for this night." That's Grace was living in Soweto. So I will go with you to my house, and then you will sleep there with me. After the morning, I'll come with you back. Then Nalinga said, "Okay." She thanked her, thanked Grace. And then she even appreciates her. So when they were going down, they separated first. They went, Nalinga and Taro went to their mother. When they went to their mother, the mother was inside the house, the big house. Nothing was there. You can't hear people talking. So they just entered the There was a gate that just knocked the gate. No one answered. Then they entered. When they entered, they heard someone shouting, "Joycey," but they did not know at first that it was their mother. So they entered. So their mother shouted, "Taro, Nalinga, what are you doing here?" So she grabbed them and hugged them. And she started smiling, laughing, and all sorts of things. So then the white woman came outside and asked, "What are these fools doing here? What are these idiots doing here?" But Ma said that these are my daughters and son, so I don't know what they came here to do, but I'll ask them later. So Nalinga explained to Ma about what has happened in the village, but she did not tell Ma Winga because their grandma would be very disappointed at them. So she did not inform Ma Winga. They just went outside and all sorts of things. So they said that they agreed that she will be coming to Grace's house, and then she will sleep there, and then the next morning will come again. And Ma said, "Okay." Then Ma take excuse to her madam, because her madam is very cross. She was very cross as Nalinga and Tyrone. So she take permission to her, and then the madam said that, "When I'm leaving you, when you're taking excuse, when you're going, don't take more than 1 week. That's okay." Then Nalinga said okay, and Ma said okay too. So they was passing by, they went up the hill, and then they met Grace standing there too. So when Grace was standing there, They started saying, "Oh, I've been waiting for you all day long. So now it's ready. It's time for us to go home." And she said, "Okay." But then they entered the train, and then on their way going home, they saw the bridge. And then this was inquisitive that she wanted to see all about all what she has passed and she did not saw. She wanted to see them once more again. So she was very inquisitive, watching over the windows, doing all sorts of things. After that, now they finally reach Grace's house. Then they enter. Grace was having two brothers. The one is Jonas and the one is Paul. But they were very cross at them. They started asking, "Grace, why did you come with these two idiots here? Didn't you know that Mama will be very disappointed at you?" And they said, "Okay, did not do anything." And they just keep on doing what Grace have asked them to do. So it was time for meal, and Grace was preparing a delicious food, and then quickly Nalindi watched up, and then she saw a photograph. And then she asked, "Grace, who is this? Just an example. Who is this? Who is that?" And she started asking all sorts of questions. And then Grace started Nalindi, and they asked. Grace answers them, and then Grace said, "Come and sit. My mother have warned us not to say this secret to anybody because it will be a problem for me. It will be a problem for the whole family." So she said, "Promise me that you will not tell anybody, and then no one will hear about this." Then Nalindi said, "Okay, I promise you. Because when you give promise, you have to fulfill the promise. You have to go change and all that and change, because it will not be good. Next time, the person will not tell you secrets." So when she has told her everything about Dumi, she said, "That's her eldest brother. Dumi was one of the eldest son that his mother gave birth to." So he said, "One day they were in school, and then Dumi, they wanted to do a match pass. So they got a banner like this. He was holding it like this, and then he started saying, 'Blacks are not dustbin.' That was the word that was written there. 'Blacks are not dustbin.' Because the white people used to treat them all sorts of things. They separated them, black from white, white from black. Even if they went to beaches, countries to countries, they said, 'Only blacks should sit inside this car, only blacks should sit inside this motor.' They differentiated them. If they went to beach, that's what we say, 'Only black, only white.' The school that they used to attend in South Africa, they said only black should go to this school, only white should go to this school. The black people only learned about how to be houseboys, cook, securities, and all sorts of things. And then the white people now also how to be doctor, nurses, pilots. They have quality education at that time. The white people were ruling them. Because we don't have the one that to stand, hold, I'll stand for this purpose, and then I will come for this purpose. No one was there. All of them were shy, leaving everything to the white people. The white people are disturbing them, you know, sort of thing that they're not supposed to do. So when they went to Nalindi and Grace's house, that when Grace had two explaining, he said, "Dumi was my eldest brother. And then he was not afraid of anything. As soon as he saw something that is affecting him, he ran there and discussed what about what and what and what. And then after that, it will come to pass." So now Grace was having such a brother that is not afraid of anything. Whatever he said he's doing it. So after they have put their written, "Blacks are not dustbin," so we are marching, doing march past. When the police saw them, the police started shooting, because they don't like what Dumi and the others have done.